The Energy Recovery System, or ERS, gives Formula One drivers the ability to apply a push-button speed boost at any time during a race. They can use it to attack an opponent on an overtake, make up time on an undercut, or save it up to defend against a faster opponent. However they see fit, really. It's up to them on how they use it. ERS is a weapon that drivers can use for offense or defense, albeit with some limited capacity, because it's connected to a rechargeable battery, and when that battery is out of energy, it's got to recover, hence the name. With the aid of this electrical support, the top cars are able to produce approximately 1,000 horsepower, which is like a million Nissan Sentras. Formula One cars today are hybrids. They use a 1.6 liter V6 turbo hybrid engine utilizing 95 to 102 octane unleaded gasoline,
winner!
As well as electricity. You heard me right, battery power.
21 gigawatts!
And it's not just a Ford and go type of situation here, oh no, it's a game. A critical part of every Formula One team's race strategy week in and week out on the race calendar, managing the ERS system to maximize wins on tracks that suit their car and limit losses on tracks that don't. If you've ever seen a rear light on an F1 car flashing when it isn't raining, you're seeing ERS at work. It's recovering energy. On TV, you'll hear them describe it as harvesting energy, but they're not telling you which kind of energy, so I will, because it matters. It's both kinds, heat and kinetic.
Oh, we got both kinds. We got country and western.
You see, ERS isn't just a part or component. It's a system that takes energy from the turbo and the brakes and turns it into electrical energy by way of three parts: the MGU-H, MGU-K, and the energy store. I'm sure you've heard of these parts during practice sessions, as they do get changed out during the race year and can have a drastic effect on a car's performance during a season. And yes, this is about to get a little technical, but I'll try to keep us out of the weeds. Okay, let's go. The motor generator unit heat, or MGU-H, serves as both a generator and a motor and is the most complicated part of the ERS. As a generator, it can create and supply electricity that goes to the energy store, the battery, or directly to the MGU-K to increase the crank power. Think overall car speed. As a motor, it turns heat from the turbo into electricity while simultaneously eliminating turbo lag. If your personal vehicle is a four-cylinder turbo, which is pretty common, you can feel turbo lag when you press on the pedal and it takes a couple of seconds for the car to really accelerate. That's turbo lag. And then an F1 car, it can act as an anchor, preventing max acceleration. So to prevent turbo lag, the MGU-H will spin the turbo on its own at low speeds, providing much needed compressed air into the engine. So the MGU-H is always operating in the background to support the turbo. When the turbo is active, it's creating heat that the MGU-H takes and converts into electricity, which can then be used for the ERS speed boost, which is what we're focusing on today. Fun fact, drivers are allowed 3 MGU-Hs per season, and anything above that will result in a grid penalty. Isn't that nice? And here's the rub.
It's time for the rub.
The MGU-H is so complex and expensive that it's actually prevented teams from entering F1. There's no mass manufacturing value for it because it isn't used in production vehicles. It's really only used in F1 itself. And as it's looking now, the MGU-H will not be a part of the new formula in 2026. And while an F1 car benefits from the MGU-H, it also needs the MGU-K to generate enough electricity to really give it some juice. The motor generator unit kinetic, or MGU-K, is much more simple than the MGU-H. It harvests electricity when the car slows down and adds power when it speeds up, as it's attached to the crankshaft. When a driver brakes, it takes the physical kinetic energy and turns it into electricity where it's stored in the battery. The driver can use this electrical energy from the battery to add another 160 brake horsepower to the car. And since it's relying on physical action, the race environment can drastically affect how much electrical energy is recovered and how effective the MGU-K is during a race. The amount of braking zones on any particular track, the intensity of the braking, and how long a driver pushes at full speed can make a massive difference. So the engineers make adjustments to it each race throughout the season. They match it to the track, the car, and the driver. Historically, this was a standalone system that used to be known as the Kinetic Energy Recovery System, or KERS. However, it was replaced in 2014 by the multi-system ERS. So, The MGU-H and the MGU-K are both sending electrical energy to the battery to be used to make the car go vroom. But how much energy are we talking here? Well, probably less energy than it takes to run a Formula One YouTube channel. And while I don't have an overtake button, I do have a like and subscribe. It provides power to the channel and keeps me in the race, just like an F1 Cars energy store. And leave me a comment below on what you think of F1 Cars as hybrids, because it might not be this way forever. After all, F1 wants to reduce the weight of the cars, and an F1 car's battery weighs between 44 and 55 pounds. It's like half the size of some of these drivers, man. The car's lithium-ion battery that's receiving and spending all of this electrical energy is also known as the energy store. It can deploy 120 kilowatts of power, which roughly equates to 160 brake horsepower to the car's power unit, which is approximately the duration of 33 seconds of boost per lap. Per technical regulations, energy store is able to only expend 4 megajoules per lap, but can only recover 2 megajoules from the MGU-K per lap. But there is no limit on how much it can harvest from the MGU-H.
Hey, McFly, you bojo!
Once again, this is where the team's engineers and driver come into play to tweak the strategy on how and when to expend the energy. So, armed with this stored electrical energy, teams can pre-select areas on the track where they can make up time and attack or defend accordingly. There's limited information on how exactly drivers activate their ERS on the wheel. In fact, teams consider their actual steering wheel configurations to be classified, but are pretty forthcoming with the basics. Mercedes has a straight-up overtake button they use to apply all their hybrid energy for a boost of speed, and they're not shy about it. A couple years ago, Carlos Sainz showed us Ferrari's charge button, which harvests the car's energy back to the battery. So it's likely he just turns it off when he wants access to the extra battery power. The driver is also able to determine how much energy is harvested or expended via the state of charge setting, or SOC, or SOC. You might have seen F1 on TV and heard engineers tell their drivers to switch to a different strat mode or SOC SOC mode. It's not exactly the same across all teams, but the principle is basically the same. For harvesting more or less electrical energy from the MGU H and K that's currently being used, or a neutral setting which keeps a harvesting and the usage of the same, basically incremental levels depending on the setting. Fun fact, back in 2020, teams specifically Mercedes were using a setting called party mode. It gave the engine extra revs and diverted zero power to the battery while making it 100% available for use during a single lap, allowing them to dominate qualifying sessions. But the F1 overlords didn't take too kindly to that sort of thing and made it illegal mid-season, actually. I know it's a bit early to start talking about the 2026 formula changes, but it's definitely going to change the current hybrid system, if there's even a hybrid system at all. I wouldn't mind it sticking around if and only if they bring back those screaming V10s. Man, that sounds freaking awesome. Okay, that's all I got for this week, guys. I think I'm going to focus on F1 tech the next couple of videos. Maybe a top 10 or a comparison between F1 and IndyCar. Let me know what you think. Thanks for coming by. Keep kicking ass. I'll see you in the next one.